Okay, hello everyone. Good to see you back for the ones who have already joined us this morning, and welcome to all who join us now. We're going to do a session where we're going to have some live scenario planning, so that should be exciting. We're also going to do a session where we talk about the future of air travel. So some of us are either directly impacted because you're part of the industry, or directly impacted because you're used to enjoy flying, or directly impacted because you have to fly to get, for instance, like many of our students, to the campuses and back to your families, etc. So I think it's going to be a fun session. A little bit of housekeeping. So this type of session allows you to write all kinds into the Q&A, which we'll also monitor. You will not be able to speak up, but it's going to be a quite interactive session nevertheless in the Teams chat, but then also in the Miro board, which we're going to work with later on. We received already previously a number of registrations, and those have been processed in the way that you receive then the Miro link directly. We will not presumably post the Miro link directly here on Teams. So if you don't have this link to this Miro board, then do send an email to Lisa. And I think we could post, however, Lisa's email address in the chat here. So without further ado, then let me just introduce us. So we are the chair for Foresight Innovation and Transformation of the EDEC Business School in France. I could also say the EDEC Business School, which has also a campus in Singapore and a campus in London. Our main two campuses are in Nice and in Lille, where I'm enjoying some rainy weather this morning. As a chair, we help organizations to work in uncertain environments, very complex environments, using tools, among others, of scenario planning, and we also develop new tools for foresight and innovation, foresight and business strategy, foresight and corporate strategy. So that's me, that's us as a chair. Now, the session is going to go quite fast into working with this Miro tool. Before we do that, there's a small poll, because I also want to get to know you a little bit, who is sitting on the other side of this virtual space. Then we work with scenarios. And then we're going to also do a little bit of a forecast into the future of the airline industry. So the first thing which I would like to invite you to now getting active is through a tool which is called WooCLAP. What I typically do when I work with WooCLAP on the other side is that I'm taking my mobile phone, taking a picture to this 3D barcode, and then navigating to that link. The other path is through the link which you have in Teams, which Lisa has posted for us there. And then that takes you directly to a poll, which I'm opening right now. And then I'm also going to go to the results. So let me open it now. This is really just a poll to see a little bit who is on the other side. So what kind of preferences do we have, etc. I'm going to show you the results as they come in live. I hope you have found now your way to the board. I suspect, see, I think in the Q&A section, indeed, we have also our link there, and I can see the first results coming in. So that will be something which you're going to enjoy here together with me. As the results come in, we can also watch them. So here we go. We have a lot of people who like flying. You see how I asked the question was not I like flying in COVID times, which is for many feels much worse. We didn't talk about this a lot in the session earlier today. What is also the difficulties of flying? In the session earlier today, we also saw some of the student ideas as little videos which they produced on what to do about having more fun flying within the COVID times. But here already a 7 out of 8 saying I do like flying. Then there is one person only so far working in the airline industry. You can see there's quite some more already on WooCLAB, maybe trying to work out how to get the votes over here, or WooCLAB service being overwhelmed for now. So one person working in the airline industry. I saw also some registrations for the larger session from airline pilots. So also nice to see you here with us. There's also 4 which have already worked in projects with the airline industry. 3 who have worked with scenarios, and 1 who has already worked with a scenario sprint. So that's fantastic. We talk about sprints in particular because we can, with also these virtual tools which we have worked with today, speed up processes which otherwise take sometimes weeks. And also because these new type of formats which we have available for either virtual collaboration spaces like we're going to use today, or through then also live workshops, but in the sprint format, allows us also to enhance participation. And that's what is always key in foresight activities. So some more numbers coming in. Thanks very much for keep voting here. I will also come back to this one a little bit later. We're also going to use WooCLAB later on once we have the scenarios. So this is something to then also acquaint yourself with how WooCLAB works and how to get into it. For the ones who might have missed the link, it is either in Teams available, or I'm also going to show now again the 3D barcode, which you can scan with your mobile phone to get into our tool here. So let me take you back to my little introduction to the session. So to that one, I'm just going to leave that just for a few seconds for anyone who still wants to participate in the poll from before and needs to scan that in. It's rather straightforward once you open your mobile phone, and in most mobile phones it's enough to have the photo app open, and then the photo app shows you that there's a link, and then you can get in. Now, why are we here? Well, we are here because we are in a industry which is seeing a truly unprecedented crisis. This was an overview which was created by ICAO, which I found particularly impressive because it shows you all the types of challenges the industry has faced so far. And you do also see clearly the dips in the growth curve. We also see that the growth in air travel has been quite strong, also with tendencies to become even faster and faster in recent years. And then the pandemic happens, and we have 60% decline. And if that would have been short-lived, then one could have had utilized normal tools to raise a crisis, so putting people on furlough, grounding planes for a while. And with many companies which we work with in the industry, that was also the initial idea. Let's go into a kind of hibernation, let's wait this out, and then let's come back when everything is back to normal. Now, whether everything is going to go back to the pre-COVID levels is something we want to discuss today, and also what is potentially other alternative futures for that industry. Now, we have been working with the airline industry now for the last 6 months with a number of different players. This is what we as foresighters, as strategists, we are particularly excited about to look at changes from through the eyes of different partners in a industry value chain, or as I show it here, more a value network. So you see 2 major airlines, you also see 2 major airports, you're seeing IATA as the industry body of the airline industry. You see also intermediates like Amadeus. You're seeing manufacturers like Thales, Airbus, and each of those partners has, of course, a different view on this. And to have a meaningful discussion, we did first horizon scanning, so looked into what is driving that industry. And then we worked a lot with scenarios. And the advantage of scenarios is that you can bring the discussion which you have in your organization to other organizations. You can also internally bring it to more people. So it's about opening up a strategic dialogue and allowing also for complexity in that strategic dialogue. The basic idea for the ones who are a bit newer to scenarios is this one here. So essentially we would be saying that we typically have a belief, maybe even a very dominant belief in an industry, that the future of an industry will be looking in a particular way. So as we saw from just extrapolating the trend from the past, it looked like an industry which is doomed to grow. And that was a rather stable trend, 3-4 in some markets, up to 10% annual growth rate over the last decades. And it looked like there's no end to it. This is sort of what is sort of my middle circle here. This is what everyone expects. Now, what we're trying to do with the scenarios is to be systematic about broadening our view on alternative futures. And what we're trying to do with this is that from this inner circle, which I call here the plausible futures, we want to have some views on what potential futures are out there to challenge our current strategy, see how robust it is, to think about new strategies, to open up then also new strategic options, and to be able to move closer to also working with those strategic options, either inside your own organization, which is hard enough, or even across the value chain, which is really what an industry needs in times like these. Now, there's multiple ways of building such scenarios. What we want to do today is a method which we have developed ourselves from the connoisseurs of scenario planning. One could say this is sort of a good blend of the intuitive logics tradition of saying, let's be open about what kind of futures we have. This is what is shown here on the lower part, that essentially a scenario, and these little eggs here are supposed to represent those scenarios. They can come from having a first dominant factor in mind. And then we build the scenario around that. And here comes some new developments in the method, which is using a lot of pre-developed understanding of what is influencing this industry. So what it looks like is that we have in principle such a core first. So the core is often represented by one or two influencing factors in their extreme state. And then in the first round, we work typically across different stakeholders on what does that mean for the industry itself. So this is what's often also called the transactional environment. So what's the changes for myself and for the value chain partners with whom I work all the time. And what is then interesting to have also a view on the contextual environment. And here we would like, also because we are here in this context of a UNESCO activity, we want to take the broadest possible view. Sometimes one takes also smaller view, saying what would that do then to my direct stakeholders, for instance. But here we want to challenge ourselves to say, what does that mean for people, so humanity, for everyone, and that can be different for different people, obviously. For prosperity in general, the aviation industry has, for instance, not been taxed on their CO2 emissions because we believe in a strong link between the ability to travel the ability to do commerce, and then prosperity. And finally, there's this element of planet. So what do we do here in that scenario to environmental issues, to social issues, etc. So that would be what we want to play with in a minute. And for that, we want to take you now to Miro. Before I'm going there myself, here's sort of the first representation of what the scenario activity will look like in Miro. So it's the same egg, and you see already some other things. So it's now the moment where you need to relocate your Miro link. So in my case, that is already open. If you're lacking the link, Lisa's email address is still in the Q&A section from this Teams meeting. So you could still mail back to Lisa, and hopefully you're not all doing this at the same time. Or you do find actually this email, which Lisa has sent to you earlier today to access the Miro board. So I'll be now also moving over to my browser to meet you in Miro. And then taking you there as well. And I'm seeing the Miro room is already filling up nicely, so that's a good thing. So just for the ones who are the first time in Miro, a couple of hints how to navigate here. You can zoom all the way out, and then you see all the stuff which we have put on this board. You have actually unlimited place, so you can move anywhere you want. I can also drag you to where I am, so that I'll be also doing from time to time. So for now, I let you zoom around here a little bit. And then you should have on the left-hand side, like here in my case, you have a toolbox where you can take the arrow to point at things, move things around. You can have little post-it notes, so I'll be just taking a post-it note to show you how that works. It's very small now, but it's very intuitive to use, so you can click on it, you can move it around, can start typing on it, etc. So all this is rather natural, as you know, maybe from programs like PowerPoint, etc. Now, actually, to warm us up here, I would like you to come to me for a little warm-up exercise here in the introduction questions. And for that, I can also summon you. So everyone should be dragged now to this slide. The idea here is now that you first take a little star here, like I'm doing myself. And for every line, you're taking this star to where you want to go. So for instance, in my case, how many times have I flown since COVID started in short haul? Well, for me, it's actually 2 times. So that would be here, my star. In mid haul, 0 times. Actually, I didn't put that here, but it would be maybe interesting to also symbolize a zero here, just so we know that people are with us. And same thing in long haul. I will not disclose what this would have looked like if it would have been a normal year. But that is a good exercise to warm yourself a little bit up, to see how things go. And also when you work with your colleagues, it's always good to have some first exercises like this one in Miro, so that you get comfortable with moving things around. Wow, I'm impressed about this first guest maker here, who has flown already more than 5 times. Wondering if we have now first evidence of being an airport pilot, potentially, on this board here. So I let you you race around that one here a little bit. And you can then also already move gradually down a little bit. There's also some long haul flights. Wondering if that's maybe some of my students who simply do that to go back to their families. So it's an interesting picture here. I think it's fair to say in a normal year, we would have probably seen much more stars here towards the right-hand side. Once you're done on the top board, we can also take you to the board further down, where I'm asking about 3 years into the future. So we're still getting the discussion today about vaccines and when will they be ready, and all kinds of questions about how to deal with the sanitary crisis. We take 3 years here because this is what many suggest is when we will have tackled the current sanitary crisis. But of course, you would like to factor some more questions into your answer here to say, well, me personally, would I feel comfortable again of flying? Would I feel I'm prosperous enough to go to my nice holiday getaways where I need to fly to, etc., etc.? So I'm now looking forward to see what the feedback will be on this one. Good. So we're seeing actually quite a lot of us sort of here in the middle ground saying, and presumably similarly like before. So that would please the airline industry to say, well, at least we're seeing that people who are here in the session are comfortable enough with that idea that we'll have overcome the imminent sanitary crisis. Is something to look forward to in terms of same customer journeys as we had before, etc. There's also still some people who are doubtful about that, say I'll be probably flying less. So all kinds of other questions you could ask yourself. So when we prepared this session once for a much larger audience, which also had more time to work with this. Here we limited today ourselves to 30, just in order to make sure that this is very stable here today, the session. You can also use, for instance, different color stars to work out, are you somebody who has been flying regularly? Are you a frequent traveler from before? Or are you more an infrequent leisure traveler? You could also wonder, where are people coming from? Are they coming from Europe, from the US, from Asia? Are you coming from places where also now flight levels are picking up much faster than, for instance, in Europe, etc.? So what we did to prepare now for a session like this, and in fact, as I showed you earlier, we have also been engaged in a project over 9 months where we started with horizon scanning. So what you see on my screen now, I can also take you here, is the factors which we identified, which will influence the future of air traffic. That's typically the first step. We do then also use these kind of radar overviews, which you see right next to the list, which gives you then sort of some idea about what we ask here, for instance, how big will the impact be and when? So there's factors which really are only important on the short term, which is in the inner circle. Others are more important for the initial recovery in 2021. And then the outer factors like the 33 here, for instance, data privacy would be a factor which will be important to monitor for the world after, or sort of the new normal, as some also call that. What we also do to monitor all this is to use a platform here, which we are getting for free for educational purposes, which you see mocked up below. So this is a platform where you can do a number of things. You can track a number of factors. You see them here. I think here for me it looks quite poor quality. I don't know if this is just due to my connection. But essentially, there's a number of factors here which we monitor, including what's the level of propensity to fly, which we see here. We're also monitoring more economical factors, like to which extent is this long distance trade being affected, etc. And these foresight platforms, in this case, this is an Itonics platform, allows you then also to keep monitoring this over time. It brings you new news, which on that factor are being published directly into the platform. And with that, you can keep track of the drivers of change for an industry. And the next step is then really to take these factors and start your strategic thinking. And this is where we are entering then these scenario wheels. So I'm going to bring you over here. So the scenario wheels you're seeing here are structured as you have seen before in the PowerPoint. And there is already a first set of influencing factors. So you see we have used a steep categorization here, which many of you know from environmental scanning, some social factors, some technological factors. Sorry that for whatever reason we don't have any ecological factors, but we did have quite a lot of ecological factors in the original scan. We discussed also this morning a lot about flight shaming and more the social will to not engage as much in flying for whatever reasons. And the first thing you then typically do is to say, let's look at what this scenario core is about. So in this case, it's a scenario which we have called the humble future, a cautious resurgence. And there's a couple of factors which define that core. Slow and steady demand recovery, contamination of the COVID-19 is stagnating, quarantine measures are less restrictive, etc., etc. And then the strategic thinking really starts when you start interpreting what that means for the aviation industry. So I could go over to the influencing factor and drag one over, for instance, and say, well, a prolonged recession could be also part of this. So I'm putting this here up to prosperity. Not going to do it here because I want you to do that. But the idea is then that you first use some factors which you might have researched before, and then you also add new ones. So we have also given you some empty ones here on the left-hand side. So in a minute, I'm going to start to let you loose on all of this and to have some rules in place that it works smoothly. I'd like you to do two things. One is that you create for yourself a name tag. So I'll be doing this now for myself. I'm going to take this out, say I'm Renee. And now I take my name tag and go where I want to go with this. So if I'm saying, well, this first scenario is appealing, that I'm staying right here. And then I'll be seeing who is co-creating with me right now on that screen. It's not so much the point that you need to disclose necessarily your identity. The main point is that we all not all working on just one scenario. So the two things you need to do before I let you completely loose on it, but then you should try to distribute roughly equally on the different scenarios and simply get working by adding new descriptive features on the scenario X start essentially defining what's going on in that scenario. So I'll be moving a little bit out to let you a little bit more space. I can see Lionel wants to join, for instance, scenario one. I do hope people also move a little bit further down. Scenario two is a scenario dealing with a lot of growth. We call this the sky is the limit. So a big comeback in terms of demand. On the third one, this is what we call flying for the privileged. This is a much smaller air traffic market with much higher prices. And the last one is this regional rebound, which is a lot about what we see now, for instance, that the, within China, traveling is almost back to pre-COVID levels. And so is also the regional recovery, but it's not completely global. So I'm going to set ourselves a timer of 15 minutes to now start working on these different scenarios. So take your name tag with you. You can move from scenario to scenario, but take your name tag then with you so that we can at any time see roughly who is working on the scenario at the moment in time when you're watching. Good. Super. It takes a moment to get used to it. You'll see that in Miro, there's also some old friends which work, for instance, holding the control key and dragging a item, a impact factor or so will double it. So some of the shortcut keys, you know, from your keyboard in other programs also works here in Miro. So have a look how that works. Okay, so I can see people get comfortable with the tool. Oh wow, Matt, nice to see you here. Okay, that's always interesting what people select here. Just checking out a little bit here the different scenarios, but you shouldn't feel disturbed, so I'll let you also concentrate. That's why I'm playing a little bit of music here. So So this is looking very nice. I can see people are getting comfortable with also navigating in this. Once the scenario is starting to be filled, it's always nice to also go back and check a little bit what the others have written in order to really immerse into these scenarios, starting to understand what's going on, starting to really put yourself into that future. We have not specified here in which time frame that should be, but it's probably also this sort of beyond 2023, 2025, where much of the sanitary crisis, imminent problems have somehow be dealt with through vaccines or through more of also eradicating it through not allowing it to spread, etc. We are on the flying for the privileged. It's the small planes back. Still remember the very first webinar I was participating as a participant was from the World Economic Forum, and I still remember the first speaker was a guy running a private aviation organization, and he was literally very pleased with himself during that interview, saying, you know, that's going to be the time for private aviation, where we go to much smaller planes, where the trip basically follows your needs, and where a lot of those big network airlines will have a very hard time to compete with us because they lack the planability. So what also comes for me always in a scenario flying for the privileged as an extra feature is that probably is also because of the lack of planability in the entire network, because you need, as a network airline company, you need a lot of planability in order to be able to fill your planes and then fill the big planes and bring the per unit costs down. All the parts of messages,
know this far long. I hope you know I wouldn't change a thing. Your hands on me, those memories I beat to your face. And I can't break the cycle of you in my mind, oh. This is the place that I want to forget you. These are the nights that I dream to regret you. These are the times I know I can't replace you. Whisked out somewhere else, whisked out somewhere away. This is the place that I want to forget you. These are the nights that I dream to regret you. These are the times I know I can't replace you. Whisked out somewhere else, whisked out somewhere with you. Somewhere with you. My love for you will never run cold. And I can't break the cycle of you in my mind. Oh, this is the place that I want to forget you. These are the nights that I dream to regret you. These are the times I want to forget you. Whisked out somewhere else, whisked out somewhere away. This is the place that I want to forget you. These are the nights that I dream to regret you. These are the times I want to forget you.
And I can see from all the scenarios, the flying for the privilege can probably use the most input still. I think that's interestingly a less engaging scenario potentially, but maybe one which will come back. Maybe time travel more to the back, but maybe also to the future. Okay, we have 1 minute and a half still building time. Then when the clock stops, then I want you to take your name tag then with you and join me in the Dream Team home, which is on the top right corner, but only when the timer goes off. Timer. So thanks very much for working so fast. Please join me now with your name tag in what I called here the Dream Team home. So this is all the way up here. Sorry for dragging you. You need now to go back and find your name tag and bring your name tag up to the Dream Team home up here. Super. Good. So I can see the name tags have found their way to the Dream Team home. Who is still out there and needs to bring their name tag up here as well? Come join me on the Dream Team home. Wonderful. Good to see you, Matt. Unfortunately, it's only one-way communication in this webinar, but good to see also a number of good friends here as well. Super. Stati is also there. Wonderful. Also the creme de la creme of scenario planning. Super. So what we often do is sort of that in between sessions is that here, for instance, we reunite and we could ask questions, for instance, who has, when they were working on the scenarios, who has thought about the wider implications for the rest of the supply chain of mobility services. So who has also thought about implications for wider mobility services? Please follow me to yes. So I was, can put myself there, but I'm sort of losing contact with my own thing here. So I would have thought about that because we're thinking about that right now together with the partners a lot. I can see I should sort of bring that to the back or simply take that one out and use it like that. This is something which we do often so regularly, so little check-ins. So have I thought about, for instance, the value chain for mobility services in general? Have I sufficiently thought about what this is going to do to for instance, the social cohesion around the globe, if we are not able to visit other cultures, would that be a huge impact, etc. So one can do these little polls and also start feeling a little bit who else is in the room, what kind of ideas do they have. I think we already worked hard, so you can give all yourself a clap, and I'm giving you a clap that you worked already hard on these scenarios. Now, the first idea of working with these scenarios is to give us the ability to immerse into them and really start feeling what's going on in that scenario. Now, the second thing I would like to do here with you today is to give you 2 minutes to form an opinion. What is for you the most likely and the most desirable scenario? So these two questions I'm going to ask in WooClap in a minute. And before I do that, I would like to give you now 2 minutes to go once more through those scenarios and ask yourself what's the most likely and what's the most desirable for you. So let's take 2 minutes to review the scenarios. Oh. Good, so that was our timer. Now I'm going to take you back to our Wook Lab. I can also see that some more results have been coming in Wook Lab on the earlier question, and we'll share those also. But let's move now to the first question. So in terms of likelihood of those scenarios, do you think we're going to have a humble future is your most probable one? Or do you think it's going to be the future fly, so a big comeback to a lot of flying? Or will it be rather the flying for the privileged? Remember that the link to the Wook Lab is in the chat. I think it's the best to go back to the chat. Or will it be flying for the privileged? So only for the small amount of people, more expensive, maybe for only the very important business travel, or for the very rich. Take your pick. Okay, so far only two in the race. Who thinks about the regional rebound, which is actually what we're seeing now in the short term happening a lot? So we have regional flight levels going up quite fast, particularly in Asia. In China, we're almost at 100% again, while the intercontinental traveling is not happening. Well, I can see so far is only two scenarios in the game. Regional rebound comes in as one which has also a certain likelihood. Good. Flying for the privilege. This is something which we don't see coming that much. Okay. So interesting picture on the likelihood. So here we have the humble future clearly winning. Regional rebound also coming in. That particularly these crises seem to be more containable if you are in more of a monolithic type of environment. Okay, thanks very much for that. And let's move to the desirability. Which of those scenarios would you feel is the most desirable for you? Future flies, yes. What's that? Good. Humble futures, it's also okay for many. Also no takers here so far on the flying for the privileged. Good. Maybe reaching a rebound is also, at least for one, saying, yeah, that actually also has some desirable aspects, that we stay connected with more the near environment. Also going back to previous levels is here the most desirable, but not the most probable here so far. Okay, so interesting picture. Of course, we could have easily also made the choice of asking you the same question, but with your name tags, so that we can also see what are the opinions in the room. Here we said it's more interesting to not see who wants it, but have it as anonymous so that we privilege sort of the true answer, so to speak, and not the one which you might want your boss to see if you do this in a real environment. That is typically something which then also is good to trigger a completely new round of working with the scenarios. Now, our session is now coming slowly but surely already to an end. We wanted to have that sweet and fast. You can stay in touch with us in many different ways. Lisa is going to share through the Q&A also some links to our newsletter and so on. great to see also some friends here in the session today. Thanks for joining. We also can still take some questions through the Q&A, which we can also answer afterwards. And we're also ready to share the recording of the session and ready to share also the final scenarios you worked on. To get those, please send Lisa an email. Once more, even if you have sent one before, and saying, Lisa, I would like to have the post-processing of this activity. To conclude, I just want to highlight that the idea of co-constructing scenarios in this way can be also put to a large audience. So we regularly do this also in large organizations for 200, 300, and 400 people, because in particularly this type of interaction, you can then invite many in one session, and you can also run and replicate sessions. And the idea of this is that you really co-construct the understanding of the future and therefore also lay the fertile ground for implementing, for moving towards those futures. So I hope this was an inspirational activity for you today. And we hope to stay in touch with you on. It's not only co-constructing desirable futures which is at stake, but I think we also need for everyone out there to have the methods and tools to think in innovative ways about complex and desirable new futures. So thanks for joining today, and hope to stay in touch with you.